Heavenly Father, we thank you and we praise you for your word. It is the truth, and we receive it written in our heart, written in our mind. Thank you for the revelation of it. We will be hearers and doers of it. In Jesus' name, amen. Please be seated if you would. We've been sharing many messages for some time that are preparing you to be a part of the holy, glorious church. Without spot, without wrinkle, walking uprightly before the Lord, growing up in all things. And today we're going to begin a series of messages on the subject of you being led through the spiritual wilderness to possess the promised land. We begin in Amos 2, verse 10. He said, "Also I brought you up from the land of Egypt and led you 40 years through the wilderness to possess the land of the Amorite." Egypt is a type of the world where they were under bondage to Pharaoh. Well, Pharaoh is a type of Satan. You and I have been delivered from the authority of Satan. We have been brought into relationship with God through new birth. He is our Heavenly Father. Now we are under the covenant in the New Testament, having been born again. We have been delivered out of this world. We've been delivered from the authority of Satan. And notice, he led him 40 years. 40 is the number of testing through the wilderness. The wilderness is that which was leading them, the place they were going through to get to the promised land. The promised land that you and I are headed towards is the possessing the promises of God and being able to attain to the resurrection of the dead and to the millennial reign of Jesus Christ and ultimately to the eternal place with the Father in the new Jerusalem and the new heavens and the new earth. Going through the wilderness is what you're doing in this earth. It's a spiritual wilderness. This is a place that has been bound by the devil's works, a place where there is sin. You and I are born from above, remember, we're not of this world, and this world is going to pass away. It is only here for a time. You and I are only here for a time, and we are going through this wilderness, a type of the spiritual wilderness, and we're going to possess the land that God has given unto us. In the wilderness, it revealed the testings by God. It also revealed the attacks from the devil, or the enemies, which are a type of the devil. Also, where they learned the ways of the Lord in the wilderness, and through the types and the shadows, it teaches the New Testament truths that you and I are to take hold of and walk in our life if we're going to pass the test and enter into all that God has for us. The New Testament has many important things, of course, for us, and it gives the spiritual facts. But we see the Old Testament's important because it gives the details of the spiritual types and shadows in many areas. We see, as it says over in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 1, even when the law came into being, it says, "For the law having a shadow of good things to come, not the very image of things." It was a shadow, type and shadow, pointing towards the spiritual realities. We see the same thing mentioned over in Colossians chapter 2 and verse 16 and 17, where he said, "Let no man judge you in meat or in drink or in the respect of a holy day or new moon or the Sabbath days, which are a shadow of things to come," or more literally, a shadow of the coming things, as Young brings out. This is a present tense verb. Shadow of the coming things. They're all pointing towards these things. Also, the things that are written in the Old Testament are also have another important aspect, as we see in 1 Corinthians 10, 11. Now, these things happen to them for examples, and they're written for our admonition, our warning, upon whom the ends of this age, it means, not world, it's aeon, are come. It's going to come. We've written for our examples, for our admonition. Ends of the ages is actually plural in the Greek. They're going to be coming to pass. We see the fact that as you and I walk in the ways of the Lord, of course, we're to attain to the millennial age and then to the eternal age as we walk in the ways of the Lord. So we're going to be looking at things that show God's testings, how the enemy works against you, also the things that were brought forth that pointing towards the things that Jesus would accomplish, learning the ways of the Lord and getting these New Testament truths established in our life of what he wants to accomplish with us. Begin in Genesis chapter 37. In Genesis chapter 37, here it's speaking about Joseph and Jacob here in the land. His father was a stranger in the land of Canaan. And here it speaks of the generations of Jacob in verse 2, and Joseph being 17 years old. 17, we've seen in before in the scripture, is the number that is the ending of some evil that is going to bring forth a good thing after that. We've studied this in the past. Was feeding the flock with his brethren. The lad was with the sons of Bilhah, with the sons of Zilpah, his father's wives. And Joseph brought unto his father their evil report. He brought the evil report because it was time for him to know the evil that was going on. That's something. Was he being a tattletale? No. Telling someone about the evil report of another is not wrong. It is right. In order to bring knowledge to him so he knew what needed to be dealt with. God wants us to know that we need to speak forth about evil that goes on, to call people to repentance so that they will turn towards righteousness. It's not a wrong thing whatsoever. He brought the fact of the evil, telling their evil ways. Well, Israel loved Joseph more than all his children because he was the son of his old age, made him a coat of many colors, and the brother hated him. The brethren saw the father loved him more than all his brethren. They hated him and could not speak peaceably unto him. What else were the reasons why he was loved? It's because he passed the test. In Genesis chapter 49, down in verse 22, Joseph is a fruitful bough. He was fruitful, a fruitful one who did what God wanted him to do. And it also speaks also of why Joseph was blessed and why he was loved more. Verse 26, the blessings of thy father have prevailed above the blessings of my progenitors under the utmost bound of the everlasting hills. They should be on the head of Joseph and on the crown of the head of him that was separate from his brethren. The word separate is the word that's translated Nazarite 12 times out of the 16 uses, as you see in the lower window, in the Old Testament. The Nazarite was the consecrated, dedicated, devoted one, separate from the things of this world and separate from sin. That's what he was. He was one who walked in the ways of the Lord. He passed the test. The rest of them, they did not. They were evil. They did wrong things. Well, because of that, of course, God was going to use him and to bring blessings, using Joseph to accomplish his work. Of course, it's a type of Jesus who came and accomplished the great work for us. We see back in Genesis chapter 37, God gave him a dream. Joseph dreamed a dream, told it to his brethren. They hated him yet the more. And so he told them the dream, which is they were binding sheaves in the field. My sheaf arose and stood upright, and behold, your sheaves stood round about and made obeisance to my sheaf. Otherwise, you're going to be bowing before me, even though they hated him. And they said, they figured what this was about. They said, you're going to indeed reign over us. You indeed have dominion over us. They hated him more, even though it was the truth that God had brought forth. Dreamed another dream, told his brother, and said, I've dreamed a dream more, and behold, the sun and the moon and the 11 stars made obeisance to me. That speak of the mother, the father, and the 11, all the sons. He told it to his father and his brethren. The father rebuked him. He didn't understand this. He said unto him, what is this dream that thou hast dreamed? Shall I and thy mother and thy brethren come to bow down ourselves to thee to the earth? His brother envied him, but the father observed the saying. He didn't throw it out. He observed what was said. Of course, they got jealous of him. They conspired to throw him into the pit. They wanted him to die. But then God, of course, delivered him out of that and took him to Egypt, where he accomplished the things that God had set for him. That tells you something. Even though the devil will hate you for walking in the ways of the Lord and even use people to conspire against you or try to bring destructive things against you, God will deliver you out of it. He will deliver you out of it if you walk in his ways, and he will set you on the course that he has for you to bring you to the place of what he wants for you to do so you can fulfill what God has called you to do. That's exactly what happened for Joseph. We see in Genesis chapter 50, verse 20, "As for you," Joseph speaking to his brothers here, he said, "you thought evil against me, but God meant it unto good to bring to pass as of this day to save much people alive." What the devil wants to do, God can turn it around. Talks about he turns curse into blessings. If you walk in the way of the Lord, he'll deliver you out of all of the attacks of the enemy and bring you to the place of what God has for you. But you must be, as a Nazarite, must be holy, must be dedicated, must be consecrated, must be holy before the Lord and walking uprightly before him. We see in Exodus chapter 3, he passed the test. God wants you and I to pass the test. Exodus 3, verse 18. Wherever they went in the wilderness, they were always for some particular purpose. He said, they shall hearken to thy voice. Thou shalt come, thou and the elders of Israel and the king of Egypt, and say unto him, the Lord God of the Hebrews hath met with us. Now let us go, we beseech you, 3 days' journey in the wilderness, that we may sacrifice to the Lord our God. They were to go and sacrifice unto him. You and I are going to offer up sacrifices unto him. The Bible talks about, over in Romans chapter 12, verse 1, about the fact that you and I, once we're born again, we're now to present our bodies a living sacrifice unto him. I beseech you, brethren, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. You are to present yourself to be holy, and you are to offer up sacrifices unto him. They were offering up physical sacrifices with all the different sacrifices and offerings to God, all pointing towards what you and I are to do. Of course, we are now to offer up spiritual sacrifices, as we see. Hebrews chapter 13, verse 15. By him let us therefore offer the sacrifice of praise, spiritual sacrifices to God continually. That is the fruit of our lips giving thanks to his name. He wants you to be a praiser and a worshiper of God. But to do good and to communicate, forget not, for with such sacrifices, God is well pleased. A sacrifice is a giving forth of yourself. You present your body holy, a living sacrifice. You offer up praise and worship unto him. You do good. And you, to communicate, is the word koinonia, which means to have fellowship and association with others, reaching out to minister to them. That is a sacrifice, as you give out of yourself. And that's what he wants. He wants you to give out. Learn to be a vessel. You are here as an ambassador for Christ. You are here not only to minister to the Lord, but you're also to minister for the Lord. He wants to use you to minister to people. You need to make yourself a servant unto the Lord. Exodus chapter 5, verse 1. Afterward, Moses and Aaron went in and told Pharaoh and said, thus saith the Lord God of Israel, let my people go, that they may hold a feast unto me in the wilderness. They also had to go forth and begin to hold these feasts. The feasts of the Lord were pointing towards the work that Jesus Christ was going to bring forth. They weren't Jewish feasts. They were God's feasts, showing forth what was going to happen as they had to keep these feasts. The lamb was going to be killed on the day of Passover, the very day that Jesus came. They had to do this year after year. They should have recognized him when he came. Unleavened bread was the putting away of all the leaven, a type of sin, which is exactly what Jesus did for the 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. And then the first fruits. Jesus was the first born from the dead and came up and went up to heaven, poured out his blood on the mercy seat in heaven, fulfilling the first fruits. We also see Pentecost, which was the Feast of Weeks, 50 days later. And 50 is the number that of liberty, that liberty is going to come, and it speaks of liberty coming to mankind. That was the day of Pentecost, when the Holy Spirit was poured out. People could be born again, come out from Satan's authority, receive the Holy Spirit, begin to walk in the ways of the New Testament and learn the ways of the Lord. And then we come to trumpets. Trumpets was a time when it speaks of being caught up to meet the Lord in the air, the rapture. It's going to come where we're going to be with the Lord at the time of the marriage supper of the Lamb. And then the Day of Atonement, which is the time of judgment, which is going to come on the whole world when the nations are finally going to be judged. And then tabernacles. Tabernacles being that which is where God is coming to tabernacle with us. It began with Jesus' birth. It continues when he comes back to have his millennial reign established for 1,000 years. And then it will be ultimately fulfilled when the Father will come with the new Jerusalem coming down to the new heavens and the new earth, and we will dwell with him forever in the eternal state in the new heavens and the new earth. That's what the feasts are all pointing towards. And they also have personal applications in your life of the work of God being done to get you being born again, coming to the place of walking in holiness, getting rid of all sin in your life, coming to the place of bringing forth fruit unto him, coming to the place of walking in the power of God and doing the mighty works of the Lord, and coming to the place where you go on into perfection in the Lord, which is really what the fall feasts speak of personally, that work that God brings us to the place of being perfect before him. It all pointed towards that. Exodus chapter 7, verse 16. Thou shalt say unto him, the Lord God of the Hebrews has sent me unto me, saying, let the people go, that they may serve me in the wilderness. Behold, whitherto thou wouldest not hear. What else are we going to do? We're going to serve him. We're going to serve him. God wants you to be a servant. You are called to serve him. You're to serve him in the ministry that God would have for you, the things that he wants to accomplish. Every one of us are to serve him in preaching the gospel and in ministering to other people and casting out the demons, ministering healing, doing all the things that God wants. He wants you to be a servant. Remember, the servant is the greatest of all. God wants you to be a servant and learn to serve God and be a vessel for God to flow through you. We also see in Exodus chapter 12, over in verse 40, we see that God reveals that he does things on exact times. You can always count on God to do it exactly right on the day that he says. Exodus chapter 12, verse 40. The sojourn of the children of Israel dwelt in Egypt was 430 years. That was prophesied of how they were going to be in Egypt for this period of time. Came to pass at the end of the 430 years, even the selfsame day, the very day, came to pass. All the hosts of the Lord went out from the land of Egypt. God is a God who performs his word exactly. You must know that. That's why we know when Jesus is coming back in fulfillment of the Feast of Trumpets on the exact day. Remember, it says you don't know the day or the hour. That's because you don't know when the sliver of the new moon is. Is it before 12 o'clock, midnight, or is it after? Which day is it going to be? But you know it's going to be at that time. And we know that the judgment is going to come upon the nations and the fulfillment of the Day of Atonement. And we know how the Antichrist is going to be ruling beginning on the first month in the 10th day for those 1260 days, 3.5 years. We know exactly what's going to happen. These people that think that we can't know any of these things, they don't understand the Word of God. God does things exactly on the day. He did things. Jesus was the Passover lamb on the exact day of Passover, fulfilled unleavened bread on the exact day of these things. That's why they had to wait for the time and for the Pentecost, the Holy Spirit to be poured out for the exact day. God does things exactly. You can always count on him to come through and to do what he says. We see in Exodus chapter 13, verse 18. See, we need to learn all these things ourselves. Verse 18, God led the people about through the way of the wilderness of the Red Sea, and the children of Israel went up. It says, harnessed out of the land of Egypt. Why they translated that, I don't know. In one sense, it's not bad, but it really means in battle array, arrayed for battle and armed. They went armed, ready to go and fight. This word translate armed or armed men. Why? Because you're going to be fighting against the enemy. When we came out of the land of Egypt, when we got born again, now the war is on. The devils are against you. And the fight must be engaged, but with God's power and authority that he gives to us. And we're going to conquer all the enemies in our life because the devil will come against you. They were armed, ready for battle. And that is what God wants you to be. You need to be armed, put on the armor of God, be ready for battle, be ready to fight this war. You're going to be fighting the war continually throughout your life to conquer enemies in your life as well as to conquer enemies in other people's lives and be used of the Lord. Exodus 15:13. Though thou in thy mercy hast led forth the people which thou hast redeemed, thou hast guided them in thy strength unto the holy habitation. God is going to lead you and guide you step by step. He will lead you, guide you in his strength. It means you're going to be strengthened under the holy habitation. He's going to bring you to the place of being holy before the Lord. Only those who are holy before the Lord are going to enter into the land. Only those that are holy, without spot, without wrinkle, are going to be caught up to meet the Lord, to be presented unto him. He's going to bring you. That means you're going to have to get strong. And who's going to bring strength? The Lord will bring strength into you. He is the strength of your life. And he brings that forth through the word of God in you. We see in verse 14, the people shall hear and be afraid. Sorrow shall take hold of the inhabitants of Palestina, which is a type of the enemies. You must realize that the enemies are afraid of you because the greater one is on the inside of you. They try to deceive you and make you think that they can conquer you. They're liars and deceivers. You have the greater one in you and you're able to overcome. He said, goes on and he says that these dukes of Edom shall be amazed. The mighty men of Moab trembling shall take hold of them. All the inhabitants of Canaan shall melt away because they know that they can't get the victory because the true and living God was among them. Well, God's come to dwell in us and he wants to manifest himself through you. The battle's the Lord's, the victory's ours. He's given you authority over all the power of the enemy. You've been delivered out of the authority of darkness. You've been brought into the kingdom of Jesus Christ, and you are to rule and reign over all of your enemies. No weapon formed against you can prosper. Every enemy cannot stand against you. You are in a position of authority. You are to walk in victory. He says fear and dread will fall upon them. They're afraid. In reality, that's why they have to resort to all their temptations to try to deceive you. Thou shalt bring them in, plant them in the mount of thine inheritance, what God does, in the place, O Lord, that thou hast made for thee to dwell in the sanctuary, O Lord, which thy hands have established. The sacred, holy place of being holy before the Lord. Coming to the place where God is dwelling in you and manifesting you in you. You are to be his sanctuary, the holy place of the Lord. He is going to accomplish a great work. And we come down to verse 21, and they saw. He said, sing to the Lord, for he has triumphed gloriously. The horse and riders he thrown into the sea. He triumphed over their enemies. The same God who triumphed over their enemies then is also still here today, and he will cause you to triumph over all of your enemies. No enemies can stand before you. As they went forth through the wilderness, there was continual testing to see whether or not they would trust in the Lord or not. Immediately after they had the victory, verse 22, Moses brought Israel from the Red Sea. They went out in the wilderness of Shur. Here they're out in the wilderness now. They went 3 days in the wilderness and found no water. Did they trust in the Lord to provide for them? No, they got upset about it. They came to Marah. They could not drink of the waters of Marah, for they were bitter. The name of it was called Marah. So what did they do? The people murmured against Moses, saying, what shall we drink? They began to murmur and complain. That is not passing the test. That is failing the test. God does not want you murmuring, complaining. Never have any attitudes against God. He is your answer. He is your provider. He's the one who will bring everything that you have need of in your life. They failed the test. So they cried unto the Lord. He cried unto the Lord. Moses did. The Lord showed him a tree which he cast into the waters. The waters were made sweet. There he made for them a statute and ordinance, and there he proved them. He tested them. They failed. They did miserably. The waters that were bitter were made sweet. This also speaks of the state of man, because bitter was the state that man was in the fact that he was spiritually dead because of the sin of Adam, separated from God, under Satan's dominion, in a world now that was a place of destruction, where there was stealing, killing, destruction, famine, all kinds of terrible things. The state of mankind under the dominion of the devil. But he shows that this tree, which is a type of the cross, is going to be cast here into the waters, and there's going to be a change. It's going to be made sweet, or they're going to become pleasing, which means there's going to be a change, and we're going to come into right relationship with God through new birth. Otherwise, God's going to turn the bitter state of man into a pleasing state as he gets born again because of what happened on the cross through Jesus Christ. At the same time, this also teaches us bitter things that have happened to you can be turned to sweet things for you. Don't think that you are just to endure the bitter things. God will deliver you, heal you, restore you, turn things around, and bring forth the pleasing things that God wants for you in your life. He said, if thou wilt diligently hearken to the voice of the Lord thy God, will do that which is right in his sight, give ear to his commandments, keep all his statutes, I'll put none of these diseases upon thee that I brought upon the Egyptians, for I am the Lord that healeth thee. Here we see conditions given. You got to hearken diligently unto the Lord. That's obedience. You can't just do what you want. You're not going to see his covenant promises come to pass. We're in a covenant relationship. And this is the covenant name of the Lord. Jehovah Rapha, the one who is the Lord who heals us. And he will heal us if we will diligently hearken to his voice, if we will do right in his sight, if we will give ear to his commandments and keep all of his statutes. As he said, he brought them out of the place of Egypt. It's interesting that Egypt is a word here, which it looks like it just means land of the crops, but when you put it, the cursor here, on this particular word, this is where it comes from, and it means a place that has been under siege, a besieged place. If you look it up in the theological word book of the Old Testament, that's what the T-W-O-T is. It's a besieged place under judgment. That's exactly what the world is. It's a besieged place under the judgment. The devil has been judged, but it's a place where it's going to pass away. It's a place of destruction. Look at all the things that have happened throughout history and continue to happen in the world, dominated by the devil. God wants you, though, to understand, as you're walking in this spiritual wilderness of this world, in this earth, in your walk, he will enable you to overcome and to conquer and to be fruitful and victorious in the midst of a place that's cursed, in a place that is besieged and under destruction. How's it going to happen? Because of the covenant with God. The covenant name of the Lord points to the covenant relationship that we have. You must rely on the covenant. You have come into covenant relationship. You do what he says, he will perform his promises in your life. You must be covenant minded if you are going to see yourself come through victorious in this spiritual wilderness. Well, it wasn't long, of course. Chapter 16, they got through, they saw him provide for them. And here they are. We come to chapter 16, verse 1, and they're journeying on. And the whole congregation, the children, murmured against Moses and Aaron in the wilderness, murmuring again in the wilderness. The children of Israel said to him, would to God we died by the hand of the Lord in the land of Egypt. And we sat by the flesh pots, and when we did eat bread to the full, for you brought us forth into this wilderness to kill this whole assembly with hunger. Before they didn't have water, you know, you turn the waters, make it sweet. And now they don't have any food, they're hungry. Did they figure that maybe God would do something for them? No. They continued to murmur and fail the test. You think that they would begin to learn. You and I need to learn too. Not be griping, murmuring, get into doubt, get into unbelief, drawing back, all these things. No, we need to know that God will provide for us. Look what happened in verse 4. The Lord said to Moses, behold, I will rain bread from heaven for you, and the people shall go out and gather a certain rate every day that I may prove them whether they will walk in my law or no. God provides. And it's all also pointing towards the real bread from heaven. Remember, we're in the spiritual wilderness now. And what's the real bread from heaven? It's the word of God, Jesus. And you are supposed to gather the word daily. Are you in the Word daily? You need to be in the Word daily. You wouldn't go a whole day or a whole week without eating. You'd make sure you're eating your physical food. Well, are you eating your spiritual food? We need to be in the Word of God. Gather it every day that I may prove them whether they'll walk in my law or not. God is testing you. Are you going to walk in line with the Word of God or not? Every one of us need to walk in the ways of the Lord. Also, of course, this shows the fact that God's the provider, again, of our needs. He will meet all of our needs. So what they were murmuring against Moses, but what were they really doing? Moses brought them down to the truth. In Exodus 16:8, Moses said, "This shall be when the Lord shall give you the evening flesh to eat and the morning bread to the full, for that the Lord heareth your murmurings which you murmur against him." And what are we? Your murmurings are not against us, but are against the Lord. You might be murmuring against people or against things, but you're not to murmur. You're actually murmuring against the Lord. We're not to murmur against anybody or against the Lord at any time. He is the one who will meet all of your needs. Verse 12, he says, "I've heard the murmurings of the children of Israel. Speak unto them and say, at even you shall eat flesh, in the morning you shall be filled with bread, and you shall know that I am the Lord your God." How are you going to know that he's the Lord? Because he performs his promises in your life. He meets the needs in your life. You see that he performs these promises and brings them to pass for you. As he provides for you, the covenant-keeping God, you'll know that he is the Lord your God, and you put him first place. That's what they were supposed to do. You'd think they'd begin to start obeying him. They didn't. Moses said, "Let no man leave it until the morning." Otherwise, you're not supposed to leave any. Well, notwithstanding, they hearkened not to Moses. They decided to do what they wanted to do. As long as you keep doing things your way, what you want to do, you're going to keep on failing the test, and you'll keep on falling time after time. Some of them left it till the morning. It bred worms and stank, and Moses was wroth with them because they wouldn't listen and obey, unfortunately. They failed the test. And then again, they were told that they were supposed to, the 6 days you gathered, but on the seventh day, there's not going to be any. Did they listen and not go out on the seventh day? No, they continued to disobey. Came to pass, there went out some of the people on the seventh day to gather, and they found none. Of course, he says, the Lord said to Moses, "How long refuse you to keep my commandments and my laws?" God expects us to learn the word and to do it and put it in operation. Not just then go back to the ways of doing whatever I want to do or my own take on it. God wants you to pass the test and put the word of God first place in your life. Well, we come to chapter 17. All the congregation of the children of Israel journeyed in the wilderness of sin. They're now in this wilderness still. According to the commandment of the Lord, and pitched in Rephidim, there was no water for the people to drink. Well, you know what they did then? They didn't trust the Lord either. Therefore the people did chide with Moses and said, "Give us water that we may drink." Moses said to him, "Why chide you with me? Wherefore do you tempt the Lord?" Again, who's the one who provides? The Lord. People thirsted there for water. The people murmured against Moses and said, "What is this that thou hast brought us up out of Egypt, but to kill us and our children and our cattle with thirst?" Always wanting to blame God. Don't ever blame God. You have failed the test. It is sin in your life. You shut down and hinder him from working. You limit him from working in your life. Do not complain against him. Of course, what did God tell him to do? He provides. He had him speak here. He said in verse 6, "Behold, I'll stand before thee there upon the rock in Horeb. Thou shalt smite the rock, and there'll come water out of it, and the people may drink." And Moses did so, and that came forth. That shows you again, God is the one who is the provider. Verse 7, came to the place, name of the place, Massah and Meribah, because of the chiding of the children of Israel, because they tempted the Lord, saying, "Is the Lord among us or not?" They saw him provide the water. They saw him provide the food. They saw him, you know, do all these things for them and provide the water again. And now they're saying, "Is the Lord among us or not?" You should always trust in the Lord. Don't you ever think that. Wonder where God is. You just denied the Lord. You just sinned against him. You just failed the test. Don't ever think, I wonder where God is. God is ready to perform his word. He is ready always to do it. Don't ever think, wonder where the Lord is, whether he's not here or not. They failed again, time after time. Then we come to verse 8. Then came Amalek. Now here's the enemies. They were having a problem dealing with what God, putting God first place, their provider, and now the attacks of the enemy come. That wasn't happening in Egypt. Then came Amalek and fought with Israel and Rephidim. Amalek were the enemies as a type of the evil spirits that are going to come against you and are going to attack you. You are in a spiritual war. The enemies will come against you, but God's given you authority. You are to conquer them all. Verse 9, Moses said to Joshua, choose out men, go up and fight with Amalek. You're going to fight against them. The spiritual fight, a spiritual battle against spiritual enemies. Tomorrow I'll stand on the top of the hill with the rod of God in my hand. That's the word of God that's coming forth out of your mouth. That's how you release him to bring forth his power and authority and victory to come forth in your life. Joshua did as Moses said to him, fought with Amalek. Moses, Aaron, and Hur went up the top of the hill. It came to pass when he held up his hand, otherwise releasing that rod, releasing the power of God, Israel prevailed. When he let down his hand, when he wasn't releasing God through the rod, the enemies prevailed. That shows you, you got to keep fighting. You got to keep the word going forth. You got to keep the rod of God going forth out of you. You don't just quit and take a vacation or draw back. If so, the enemy will prevail. Notice that means the enemy was continuing to come. That's why we're to watch and pray and always be on guard and always be ready. You remember when they were, anything they were doing, when they were even building the wall in Nehemiah there in Jerusalem, they had one hand on the work and one hand on the weapon. They were always ready to fight. You got to always be ready to fight against your enemies. Well, they, of course, conquered them. As they did, they stayed up his hands continually, and they continued to fight, and they discomfited Amalek and the people with the edge of the sword. And then we see what he says to Moses, which is all what he says to us. Write this for a memorial in a book and rehearse it in the ears of Joshua. I will utterly put out the remembrance of Amalek from under heaven. All that means all the devils are going to be eliminated. They're a type of Satan and all the enemies coming against you. It'll happen, but you're going to find out something a little bit in a moment here, though. Verse 15, Moses built an altar and called the name of it Jehovah Nissi. That's the Jehovah, my banner of victory. He gave him victory. That's a covenant name, isn't it? That means, again, we see these covenant names being revealed through the Old Testament, revealing God is a covenant God who performs his word in the midst of a spiritual wilderness or that's evil, that is all dominated by the devil. You have a covenant with God, all the promises of God. When you engage in warfare, he will see the victory. Now, does that mean it was one fight and it was all over? No. Exodus 17:16, he said, because the Lord has sworn that the Lord will have war with Amalek from generation to generation. That means it's going to be a long war. Why? Because the devils are here from generation to generation. Through the time when before, they're all going to be conquered after the 6,000 years of the time of man having dominion in the earth, which it was given over the hands of Satan. So it's going to be from generation. That means there's going to be an ongoing war against the devil. You, though, are to pass the test by staying in the fight, conquering the enemy. Everything ever comes against you, you can get total victory. God will give you victory, but you're going to have to fight. If you quit or draw back, give up, throw in the towel, try some other way, you fail the test and you will not see the victory come forth. We see in Exodus 18, speaking about Moses. Moses is a type of Christ. And what did he do? He went, and of course, he's the firstborn from the dead. And then everybody else that receives him, we become children of God, and we are born spiritually from the dead. He had two sons, type of Christ. The sons are a type of the born-again believers. First guy's name was Gershom. He's a foreigner. You and I are born from above, and we are foreigners in this world. You got to realize in this earth, this spiritual wilderness, you're a foreigner. This is not your home. You're not of the world. You're born from above. You're a citizen of heaven, remember. You're a foreigner in this place. He said, but he'd been an alien in a strange land, sojourner in a strange land. This is a strange place from God's standpoint. It's full of sin and full of all this evil. That's not what God has. God, everything with God is in perfection. This is a place where, a strange place to him. The name of the other was Eleazar, which means God is help. Meaning in the midst of this place, alien in this strange place, dominated by the devil, God is your help to bring you through. You got to trust in him. You got to get your eyes on him. You got to know your covenant promises. You got to know the weapons of warfare. You got to know the word of God and what you are to do to see him accomplish everything that he purposes for you in your life. And he will bring it to pass. God, the God of my father, he said, he's my help and he delivered me from the sword of Pharaoh. He'll deliver you from the attacks of the devil. Pharaoh is a type of Satan. God will deliver you. At the same time, they had lots of afflictions and attacks that came against them. And that's true in the New Testament today as well. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 3. Remember, you are a soldier in the army of the Lord. He says in verse 3, thou therefore endure hardness. You will suffer attacks. You will have persecution. You will have pressures. You will have things that come against you. But God will bring you out of it. You will overcome. You can conquer it. As a good soldier of Jesus Christ, it'll happen. Well, the same time as Moses came forth, began to teach the people. We see in Exodus chapter 18, verse 20. He said, thou shalt teach them ordinances and laws, and shall show them the way wherein they must walk, and the work they must do. God teaches us his way. He's teaching you the way wherein you must walk, because you're going to walk this out in your spiritual wilderness. You're not going to sit on the sidelines and do nothing and see God do all these things. You are going to walk it out yourself as you walk in the ways of the Lord. And you're going to conquer the enemy. You're going to walk in the steps that Jesus had. He conquered every enemy. He conquered every temptation. He dealt with everything that came against him. And the work that they must do. There's a work for you to do in your own life to work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. There's a work for us to do as we're doing the works of God and ministering for the Lord, to minister to others, bring people to the Lord to be born again and ministering to those in the body of Christ. There's a way that you're to walk in, and there's a work that you must do. God wants us to understand you're going to put the Word of God first place in your life and work out all the things that God calls for you. We come to chapter 19. In the third month, the third month of Siwan, that's the time of the Pentecost, the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, which is the beginning of the New Testament age. When the children of Israel were gone forth out of the land of Egypt, you came out of that besieged place of being under dominion of Satan when you got born again, because you're born from above. You're a citizen of heaven now, remember. And now you are a new creation. You're more than a conqueror. You're able to overcome. And notice here, it says, the same day came they in the wilderness of Sinai. As soon as you got born again, the same day, now you're into this wilderness and this world dominated by the devil, because now you were under his control. Now the whole thing's been changed. Overnight, in the same day, the war is on. Many people have thought when they come to the Lord, everything should be fine forevermore. No. You just switched lords. You came out from Satan's dominion, and now you got born from above, and you're a sojourner in this besieged, strange, evil place of the world, in the wilderness of this earth, dominated by the devil. This is a spiritual wilderness you are going to go through to prove yourself, to pass the test, to conquer the enemies, to learn the ways of the Lord, to grow up in all things, to become holy, and to be ready to meet the Lord and be ready to be with him forevermore. So, they had a covenant they needed to obey. Verse 5, if you will obey my voice and keep my covenant, then you'll be a peculiar treasure unto me above all people. There are conditions to meet. Remember, but they didn't obey. They didn't keep his covenant. They died out in the wilderness. They did not see the promised land. If you don't obey and keep his covenant, you will die out in the spiritual wilderness and you will not see the promised land either. And he goes on and says, you shall be unto me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. Of course, that's what we have come in the New Testament when we get born again. We are now a holy priesthood, a royal priesthood. We are to rule and reign, and we are to become a holy nation. The church is the holy nation, which you and I are to be. Well, they were to do what God told them to do. And we come down to verse 8. Here was their response. All the people answered together and said, "All that the Lord has spoken, we will do." That should be your response. All that the Lord has said, spoken in His word, things He has said, I will do it. He returned the words of the people unto the Lord. You see, why do we pray these prayers at the end of every one of our sessions? Because we're returning back to the Lord that we're going to do all the things that He just taught us from the Word of God. That's why we do it. We're responding back to the Lord, whether you realize that or not. You're declaring all these things that you're going to do and the things that you acknowledge that He's going to do for you. We're responding to the Word that's been sown in our heart and mind. And we need to come to the place that we are going to do all the things. That's why being a doer of the Word is absolutely essential in your life. Verse 10, the Lord said to Moses, "Go to the people, sanctify them today and tomorrow." That's 2 days. What's that? That's the church age, 2,000 years. Remember, 6 days was the time of man. The seventh day, millennial reign of Jesus Christ, the 1,000-year reign of Him. 7,000-year history of the earth, and that's it. All the people out there say, "Oh, the millions of years." They're all wrong. They've been deceived. They don't understand the truth. They believe lies that have been told them. It's not true. 7,000-year history of the earth. And so, 4,000 years to Christ. That was the 4 days. 4,000 years. And so when Lazarus was raised from the dead, which is a type of man being raised from spiritual death unto spiritual life when we got born again. And then there's the 2 days. That began at the time of Pentecost. 2,000 years of the church age. What's supposed to happen during the church age? The people are to be sanctified, become consecrated, become holy, become dedicated, become sanctified and separate. That's exactly what the Nazarite. You're a spiritual Nazarite unto God. And you are to be holy, dedicated, consecrated, separated unto Him. No sin. You walk uprightly. You're to be sanctified in Him. And what's that going to necessitate? That means you've got to wash yourself. You've got to get washed of all the evil stuff that's come into you. Remember, when you got born again, only your spirit got changed. You got a new spirit. Your soul didn't get changed, and your body didn't get changed. And all the effects of the sin from the inherited generational curses, 3-4 generations back, and all your own sins and victimization in life did not get eliminated. This is where you come into the washing. Washing is to see the work of the fooler. F-U-L-L-E-R is actually pronounced fooler. Not the fuller, but the fooler. And what was he the one? He's the one that would wash the garments and get every speck of anything out of it to make it as white as possible, white as snow, to bring it to perfection. That's exactly what you and I are to do. You are to be washed clean, white as snow. All sin dealt with. All works of the flesh put away and eliminated. Crucify it daily. Everything of the world, separate from it. All the evil spirits, cast them all out. Get rid of everything that is filthy and unclean in your life. Drive it all out. Be ready against the third day. What's that? That's the millennial reign of Jesus Christ day. What's going to happen the third day? And it's going to happen exactly then. For the third day, the Lord will come down in the sight of all the people. He's going to come on the third day. Is going to come after the 3.5 years, remember, of the tribulation period. He's going to come in the sight of all the people upon Mount Sinai. And God is going to do things exactly as He says. The third day, He's going to show up. We've got to be ready for that. The second coming of Jesus Christ. You and I are to become ready. Ready means firm, stable, established, fixed. And we've seen scriptures in the New Testament, we were studying about how God wants to bring you to the place of being stable, fixed, established, set, firm in the things of God. Every one of us, that's how you're ready for the third day. Not ready, oh, I'm waiting. No. Ready because the work's been done. You got to look up this word and see what it means. Firm, stable, established, fixed. Ah, the work has been done in your life. Those are the ones that are ready for the third day. The rest of the people are not ready, and they are going to be in trouble. Well, we come down to verse 14. Moses went down from the mountain of the people, sanctified the people, and they washed their clothes. That's what is supposed to happen. And Moses went down from the mountain of the people. How did he come down to the people for us? Moses is a type of Christ. How did he come down to us? He came into us with the Spirit of Christ. That's how he came into us. When you got born again, what happened? You became a new creation. You got a new spirit. What did you get? The Spirit of Christ. He has come into every one of us. That's why we're called Christians, because we have the Spirit of Jesus Christ in us. He's come to us, and now he's coming to sanctify us, and we're to wash our clothes, be totally washed. Same time, we come to verse 16. On the third day in the morning, and it will happen early, morning's the early time, break of day, that there were thunders and lightnings, a thick cloud upon the mountain, the voice of the trumpet exceeding loud, so that all the people was in the camp trembled. What's this all about? This is the time when Jesus is going to come. This is the time when the judgments have been going on in the earth for the 3.5 years. All these thunders, lightnings, thick cloud, these judgments, this all speaks of judgments, thunders and all this. And the voice of the trumpet, this speaks of the time when there's the rapture coming forth. As it says, Moses brought forth the people out of the camp to meet with God. How are we going to meet with him? We're going to be caught up in the air to meet the Lord, and we're going to go to heaven for the marriage supper of the Lamb. That's why he brought the people, Moses, that's Christ, brought the people out of the camp. You and I are going to be brought out of this place to meet with God. This is a type of the rapture of the church. It's going to happen. When the voice of the trumpet sounded long, waxed louder and louder, Moses spake, and God answered him by a voice. The Lord came down from Mount Sinai on the top of the mountain. He called Moses up to the top of the mountain. Moses went up. Well, that's exactly what's going to happen. We are all going to be going up to be with the Lord. After this, we see in Exodus chapter 20. See, so he told them what's going to happen. He told them all the things that are necessary. He tells us all the things that are necessary for us. And so from Exodus chapter 20, verse 3 on, he starts giving them the commandments. That's the commandments of the Old Testament law. Remember, the Old Testament has been fulfilled. We are under the New Testament now. We're under the New Testament commandments of Jesus Christ. And they were expected to walk according to them, of course. And notice what he said he would do. Exodus 20, verse 6, showing mercy unto thousands of them that love me. Who are the ones that love him? The ones that love him are the ones who keep his commandments, remember? He says so, love me and keep my commandments. So he's going to show mercy unto us, and we're going to see the promises of God come to pass. Then after he goes through all these commandments, he comes down to verse 20. God's given us all these New Testament commandments through Jesus Christ. We got the Word. We got the Word of God, the Bible, the New Testament. What are we supposed to do? God is still going to be proving you and find out, are you going to walk in line with this? Look at all these things I've done for you. Verse 20. Moses said to the people, fear not, for God has come to prove you, and that his fear may be before your faces that you sin not. You must have the fear of God before you all the day long. The conclusion of the whole matter was fear God and keep his commandments, remember, in Ecclesiastes 12. Fear God that you sin not. He's coming to prove you. He's coming to test you. He's coming to find out, because the spiritual wilderness in this world is the testings of God coming forth in your life to see whether you're going to walk in the ways of the Lord or not. If you have the fear of God and you don't sin, you pass the test. If you don't have the fear of God and you continue to sin, you fail the test and you'll be in trouble. We are not to sin. Sin has no dominion over us. Remember, we're dead and we're freed from sin, as it says in Romans chapter 6. And he commanded us, do not let sin reign in your mortal body anymore. Do not yield your members unto any unrighteousness unto sin. He commanded us to do these things. We are to walk in these ways now, from now on. The Word of God, and have the fear of God before you. The fear of God is understanding that God is truly God. And he is a God who is righteous and holy. He's a God who will bring blessing to those that obey. But he's also fair and just. If you disobey, curses will come upon you. That is the only way he could be just. Therefore, We must walk in the ways of the Lord. And then we come to verse 22. The Lord said to Moses, thus shalt thou say unto the children of Israel, you've seen that I have talked with you from heaven. They were being talked to from heaven. Well, that's exactly what he's doing today. He's talking to us from heaven. It says so in Hebrews chapter 12, verse 25. See that you refuse not him that speaketh. He's speaking. Because the word here is speaking, present tense. How's he speaking to me? Through the word every time you read it. He's speaking to you. And also through the Holy Spirit who's come to dwell in you. And what does the Holy Spirit do? He takes the things from above and shows them unto you. See that you refuse not him that is speaking to you. Don't refuse to do what he says. Don't be resistant. Don't be rejecting things from what he says. For if they escape not who refused him that spake on earth, how much more shall we not escape if we turn away from him that speaks from heaven? Obviously, we won't escape. We will be in trouble. God expects you to take hold of his word, to do his word, and realize his word is him speaking to you. It's not just some nice getting some knowledge and then go off and ignore it. No. You're expected to take hold of the word that you read that is coming forth, or you hear, he's speaking to you. He wants you to take hold of it and put it in operation. You say, well, I didn't hear a voice. He's not talking about hearing a physical thing. He's speaking to you through the word of God by the Spirit. The Holy Spirit can also be speaking to you through a still small voice or various ways that he speaks. But the word of God is speaking to you continually. In fact, we even see Hebrews chapter 1 even tells us, God who at sundry times and diverse manners spake in time past in the fathers by the prophets, hath in these last days spoken unto us. How? By his Son, he's the Word, whom he hath appointed heir of all things, by whom also he made the worlds. The Word is him having spoken to us, and when you're hearing the Word, it's him speaking to you now. Hearing the Word of God. We need to put it first place in our life. We go back to Exodus chapter 20. We saw in verse 22 where he's speaking to us. Verse 24, an altar of earth thou shalt make unto me, and shall sacrifice thereon the burnt offerings, the peace offerings, the sheep, thine oxen, and all places where I record my name. I will come unto thee, and I will bless thee. That means if you will offer these sacrifices, I will come unto thee and I will bless thee. If you and I offer the spiritual sacrifices, God will come unto us and bless us. If you don't praise and worship him, don't expect he's going to come to you and bless you. If you don't make yourself a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to him, but you walk in sin all the time, don't expect for him to come unto you and bless you. He's not going to do it. If you won't allow yourself to be carrying out, doing good and doing all the things that he tells us to do, we saw in Hebrews 13 about how doing good and communicating and reaching out, those sacrifices that God's are acceptable and well-pleasing to him, he's not going to come unto you. This is why you have to live unto him. You will not see God coming unto you and blessing you unless you come to the place of understanding you're bought with a price, you're a purchased possession, you belong to him, you are not your own, and you are to live unto him. Only the few will live unto him. The many are still living their own life in rebellion to God, and they are all in trouble. We are to give out, do exactly what he tells us to do. Remember, given it'll be given. What you sow, you're going to reap. You got to carry out your part. God will carry out his part. And then we come to chapter 21, as you see what's being brought forth in the Old Testament. These are all the judgments which you'll set before him. Then he begins to proclaim the judgments. And the judgments are all laid out if they would walk in some way of sin in some way. Well, judgments will happen. God is testing you. He doesn't want to bring judgment. He delights in mercy, not in judgment. But nonetheless, what happens if you hear the word, you understand the word, you know the word, you've got the precise, correct knowledge of the word of God? What does that mean it's going to happen to you if you don't do it? Hebrews 10:26, if we sin willfully After we receive the precise, correct knowledge, this word means, of the truth, there remains no more sacrifice to sins to get out of this thing. No. But a certain fearful looking for of judgment and fiery indignation, which shall devour the adversaries. Otherwise, judgments will come if we don't obey. Does God want that? Absolutely not. He wants us to not be judged whatsoever. He wants us to be blessed. Remember, he set before us life and death, blessing and cursing. He says, choose life, of course, so that you and your seed will be of life and be blessed. That's what he wants. That's why we need to put him first place in our life. And we come down to Exodus chapter 23. We see over in verse 18. Thou shalt not offer the blood of my sacrifice with leavened bread, neither eat the fat of my sacrifice remain until the morning. You can't do anything with leavened. Had to be unleavened. Unleavened is a type of being free from sin. Leaven's a type of sin. You can't offer any of these, all these sacrifices they were offered. Anything you do, if you do it with sin, you're going to be judged. You're not going to see victory. You're not going to be pleasing God. You're not going to pass the test whatsoever. And then he comes to verse 19. And the first of the first fruits of thy land shalt thou bring into the house of the Lord thy God. That is the tithe, the first of the first fruits. All these people in the body of Christ, these pastors, even whole church groups that are saying tithing is not for today are a deceived bunch. They are all cursed and they are all in trouble. The first of the first fruits you bring to the house of the Lord, that is bringing the tithe unto him. Well, I thought it was only for the Old Testament time, they thought. No, it preceded that. It began with Abel. He brought the firstlings of his flock. It continued with Abraham. Paid tithes to Melchizedek. It continued with Isaac, who brought the tenth unto God. Then it continued through the Old Testament law, and it continues today in the New Testament. People think that tithing has passed away. They don't know what they're talking about. Hebrews 7:8. Here, men that die receive tithes. That would be someone who's a pastor or whatever receiving the tithes. And there he receiveth them. There, that must be another place. He receiveth them of whom it's witness that he liveth. Who is its witness that he liveth that's been raised from the dead? Jesus. Where is there? That's where he's at. Where is he at? He's at the right hand of the Father in heaven. Jesus receives the tithes in heaven. Anybody that tells you that tithing is not for today has been deceived, and they are cursed with a curse, and they're in disobedience to God. Those that tithe pass the test, and they'll see the blessings come on you and overtake you in your life. Those that don't will see curses surely coming upon them. We go back to Exodus. This is showing forth the things that we must know, the things that God wants to accomplish, the tests that are coming upon us. So after verse 19, after bringing the tithes, he says, behold, I sent an angel before thee. Hey, you tithe now, the blessings are going to come on you. To keep thee in the way, to bring you into the place which I have prepared. Beware of him. Obey his voice, provoke him not, for he'll not pardon your transgressions, for my name is in him. If thou shalt indeed obey his voice and do all that I speak, not some, all that I speak, then I will be an enemy to thy enemies and an adversary unto thine adversary. And he goes on and says, my angel shall go before thee and bring thee in unto the Amorites, Hittites, Perizzites, Canaanites, Hivites, Jebusites, and I'll cut them off. So here we see, because we are a tither and we've been obedient, we're doing the things that he wants us to do, and we're not doing things with sin, we don't bring sinful sacrifices, we're walking free from sin, we're a tither, we're obedient, the angels of God that minister for us, the heirs of salvation, will go forth. And they will bring us in, they'll keep us in the way, they'll bring us to the place they prepared, they'll minister for us, remember? We must obey. God would speak through the angels to them, the word of the Lord. Well, we need to obey the word of God in the New Testament. If you obey the word of God, you do all that I speak, you'll be an enemy. The angels will be guarding you, keeping you, protecting you in all your ways. They'll be an enemy against your adversaries, which are the devils. Notice also, the angels aren't going to lead you away from dealing with your enemies. No. They're going to lead you up to confront them. The angel go before thee and bring thee in unto them. You are going to fight. You have to fight in this world to cast out the devils out of you, to conquer the enemies that are operating in the heavenlies, to speak to those mountains or whatever thing that might be hindering you, to resist all the temptations and the attacks of the devil that would come against you. He's going to bring you in unto him. And God says, I am going to cut them off. God's going to defeat all your enemies. But you have to go after them. These people that want to run away and just want to not fight the fight, engage in deliverance, engage in warfare, intercession, speak against those mountains, resist the devil steadfast in the faith and so forth, speak the word in the midst of temptations, they get wiped out by the enemy because they will not do the things that God told them to do. He will conquer all of our enemies. Well, that's what we're supposed to do. And was this going to be a quick little thing? No. By little and little, I'll drive them out from before thee. It is a little by little process, remember. Until thou be increased, which means to bear fruit. What does that tell you? You have to correct all the problems for how the enemies came in. Because you bear fruit from walking in line with the word. Meaning you're going to drive out the enemies, you're going to walk in line with the word and bring forth fruit. Why didn't they have fruitfulness when they were walking in sin? They saw no blessings. Therefore, you're going to drive out all the enemies, you're going to correct all the problems and bring forth fruit in your life, and then you're going to inherit the land. Then you're going to get the prize, having attained to the resurrection, the millennial reign of Christ, and be in the eternal kingdom with the Lord in the long range. But also you're going to inherit all the promises and possess the promises of God in your life now. Now, it says, I'll drive them out. Many people say, yeah, I want God to drive them all out. Well, he will, but you have a part to play. Because he says, I set thy bounds from the Red Sea, even the Sea of the Philistines, from the desert and the river. I will deliver the inhabitants of the land into your hand, and thou shalt drive them out before thee. You and I fight together. As you war, God wars. As you cast out, God casts out. As you speak to that mountain, he speaks to it. As you put your faith in operation, you put him in operation. As you do the word, you put God in operation. He delivers the inhabitants. That means all the devils are into our hand. We have authority over all the devils. Don't think that they can defeat you. You make no covenant with them, nor with their gods. They shall not dwell in thy land. You do not let the demons stay in you. You do not let the sin bondages stay in your life, lest they make thee sin against me, which they will. For if thou serve their gods, they'll surely be a snare unto thee. We must walk free from leaven, from sin. We must cast out all these enemies. They're not to dwell in thy land. That means they'd be dwelling in you, stealing from you, taking promises away from you, stopping you from being the holy nation that God's called you and I to be, where we're bringing and coming to. Well, these guys heard all this. And then we come to chapter 24, in verse 3. Moses came, told the people all the words of the Lord and all the judgments. You know, after all those things, you're going to get judgments if you don't do this. But if you do all this, here's all the great things that God will do for you. All the people answered with one voice and said, all the words of the Lord have said will we do. There they respond again. That's what you should be saying. All the words of the Lord, all the words the Lord has said, I will do it. I will put it first place in my life. I will be a doer of the word. We come down to verse 7. He took the book of the covenant and read in the audience of the people, and they said, all that the Lord has said will we do and be obedient. It's all out of the covenant, isn't it? You have a covenant with God. He expects every one of us to do his word and be obedient. What happens if they did that? Moses took the blood. Moses is a type of Christ. Sprinkled it on the people and said, behold, the blood of the covenant which the Lord hath made with you concerning all these words. Meaning, if you do all the things that he says, the blood will be applied to you by who? By Christ, because Moses is a type of Christ. You don't do anything with the blood, remember. It's him doing it. And this is exactly what we see over in 1 John 1:7 in the New Testament declared. If we walk in the light, that means you're obedient to the word. You're carrying out doing what he tells you to do. You're walking continually in the light. Not that you just did it once in a while. Present tense. But it's also conditional because it's a subjunctive mood, a conditional statement. If you may be walking continually in the light, you've got to meet that condition. As he is in the light, the word of God you're following. We have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanses us from all sin. Because who applies it? Jesus does. Because you meet the conditions. And it will keep you cleansed as long as you are walking in the light. Present tense, ongoing. Keeps you cleansed, ongoing, from all sin. You can walk in fellowship with the Lord at all times in your life. God wants this. And so, as they're conquering the enemies, as they're walking in the ways of the Lord, being obedient, committing to do all the words of the covenant, we come to Exodus 25, verse 8. Let them make me a sanctuary. That's the holy place that I may dwell among them. That means God, who's a holy God, he can't come and dwell if in a place that's not a sanctuary, a holy place. That's why we must become a holy nation. We are to be the sanctuary of the Lord. Now, how do we come to that in our own life? We have to grow up in the things of the Word of God. It is a growth process. And that's what we see shown in Ephesians 2, 21 and 22. In whom all the building fitly framed together groweth. We grow up unto a holy temple in the Lord. You're going to be growing up to be holy. In whom also you're builded together for a habitation of God through the Spirit. Remember, he said, make me a sanctuary so I can dwell or inhabit them. When you are holy, God will inhabit you. Remember, he says, I'm come to dwell in you, but I want to walk in you. I want to manifest myself, dwell and walk in you, be your God. And that's what he wants. We're to become a habitation for God. And then we go to Exodus 28. And we see about the priests. We see about them talking about the high priest. We also see him talking about all the sons that were priests as well. Who's the high priest? Jesus, the high priest of the covenant. He had to, of course, be holy, and he was. He passed the test. He was tempted in all points, yet without sin. But it's not just for Jesus. It's also for all us, because the sons also had to have all these things upon them. Exodus 28, verse 4. These are the garments that they'll make. And look at all the garments that were had to put on this guy. The breastplate, the ephod, the robe, the coat, the girdle, all these things. Sounds like the armor of God, doesn't it? The breastplate, the girdle, the belt of truth, the coat, the robe, robe of righteousness, all these different things, the ephod, all these things that they had to put on. They were all holy garments. You must put on holy garments, which is the word in your mind, the word in your mouth, the word directing your steps, the word in the way you think, the way in your heart to motivate you in everything you do. Not only does the word in you, in the armor of God, cause you to have the power of God to release out of you, but it also brings you to the place of having the holy garments on. You are holy before the Lord, that he may minister to me in the priest's office. Because we're to be a kingdom of priests, and we are to minister unto him. And as he talks about this, he says, you take the gold, the blue, the purple, the scarlet, and the fine linen. Gold speaks of the divine things of God, the divine nature of God, all the things that come from God. You know, everything, all the different things that are gold. You think about all the things that were made in gold. The mercy seat was in gold. The cherubims were in gold. The candlestick was in gold. The altar was in gold. All the utensils were all in gold that they had to make. The crowns were crowns of gold. Jerusalem, the heavenly city of Jerusalem, is of gold. The streets of the city are of gold. It's all talking about that's everything of God. And so this speaks of the divine nature of God coming into us, which is what happens when we get born again. The blue is that which is from heaven, because the royal apparel was blue, that which is heavenly apparel. The purple is the kingly. They had the ones they wore the purple king. The kings always wore purple when they were ruling and reigning. And then the scarlet speaks of the blood, and the fine linen speaks of righteousness. This is what's supposed to be upon you to have the holy garments. So you get the divine nature that comes from heaven, and you're a king, And you're to be cleansed by the blood of Jesus, having it continually applied to you, and you're walking in righteousness, the fine linen. That makes you a holy priest with the holy garments on, ready to walk in these ways. Well, how did they have to get to that place? Well, they had to do something to them, didn't they? This is what they did to get these priests ready to hallow them. Exodus 29:1. This is the thing that was due to hallow them or to consecrate them, make them holy, to minister to me in the priest's office. And there were three things that were required. Aaron and his sons, that would be the high priest Jesus, but also you and me. His sons, you bring into the door of the tabernacle of congregation, you wash them with water. They had to be gone through the washing, which is a type of the baptism, which is exactly why Jesus had to be baptized to fulfill all righteousness. The next thing they had to do, they take the anointing oil and pour it upon their head. The anointing, Jesus had the anointing came upon him when the heavens were open and the dove came down and that anointing of the Holy Spirit came upon him. You and I experience the washing when that's the baptism of the Holy Spirit and we get a brand new spirit on the inside of us. Remember, that's the new birth. You brought in the body of Christ. And then the Holy Spirit comes into us when we receive the Holy Spirit, having been born again, that anointing of the Holy Spirit. And then what else was necessary for this high priest to be ready? Well, the blood had to be applied. Exodus 29:20. You kill the ram, take of his blood, put it upon the tip of the right ear of Aaron, the tip of the right ear of his sons, upon the thumb of his right hand, and the great toe of their right foot, and sprinkle the blood upon the altar round about. What is it about the ear and the thumb and the toe? Those are things you sin with. You sin with what you hear, with what you put your hands to, or what you would walk in. And it's got to be cleansed. It's got to have the blood applied to it. That is the blood applied to that who has been cleansed. We get born again, we receive the Holy Spirit, and then we got to be totally cleansed to be the priest. That's exactly what they had. And it's why Jesus had to fulfill all righteousness, the baptism, the anointing. And how was the blood applied to him? It was when he was at the cross. He'd already passed all the tests, tempted in all points, without sin. And what happened? The crown of heads on his head. The blood's going down to the tip of the right ear. He's nailed to the cross. We've got the blood spurting out to his right thumb and on the great toe of the right foot. It was applied to him as he was on the cross, fulfilling that. And so, we see, you and I are to become this. We are to be the holy priests before the Lord, so that he can manifest himself mightily to us. Well, we've seen a lot of important things as you go through the Old Testament. These things are all progressive of what God wants to do in all of our lives. And it shows forth this tremendous work that he will accomplish if you and I will be obedient to him and see him accomplish his work. You're in the spiritual wilderness. You got born again. You're in a place dominated by the devil. And now you're to pass the tests of God. You're to conquer the enemies. You're to learn the things of God. You're to grow up in all of these things as we see. As we see, you're to offer up sacrifices. You're to be serving the Lord. You're to be fighting against all your enemies. God's your strength. He's going to bring you to the holy habitation. You need to come to the place of passing the tests. You can't be murmuring, griping. You got to know that God will provide for you in all aspects because of the covenant that you have with him. We also see the fact that as they fought the fight and they continued to war, it was going to be an ongoing war. Little by little, you're going to drive out the enemies. You are a foreigner in this place, but God is your help to deliver you from the attacks or the sword of Pharaoh, which are the attacks of the devil. As you go forth and you do what he says and walk in his ways, you get the teaching, you walk in the way you must, you do the work that you must do, you carry it all out, and then you come to the place of obeying and keeping the covenant to be the peculiar treasure, to be a whole part of the holy nation of God. And we saw again, time after time, all that the Lord has spoken, we will do. You are to walk after the way of the new covenant. You're to get washed during this age clean. You're to be sanctified and holy. You're to be ready, firm, stable, established, fixed, unto the coming of the Lord. Because you've seen the work established, that means you've gone into perfection in the Lord. Because the time of the judgments will come. As we get the commandments of the New Testament now that we have from Jesus Christ, we walk in them. Remember, he's speaking to you from heaven through the Word of God and by the Holy Spirit. As you offer the spiritual sacrifices to him, he'll come to you and he will bless you. If you don't walk in his ways and you sin, the judgments will surely come upon you. Everything you do is to be unleavened, without leaven, remember. As you are a tither and you're obedient to bring these things unto him, the angels will go before you. They'll bring you to the place he's prepared for you. As you walk in the way of the word, they'll guard you. They'll minister for you. They will bring you up against every enemy. You are going to cast out every devil and conquer everything that comes against you. You're not going to run away from them. You're going to confront everything. Little by little, they'll be driven out until you're fruitful, meaning you're going to correct your problems and walk in line with the word, and then you'll inherit the land. You must be committed to walk in line with the word as we've seen. Obey it, and the blood of Jesus will be applied to you continually, and you'll stay clean in fellowship with the Lord. You're to make him a sanctuary, the holy place for him to come to dwell in. You must have holy garments to be able to minister, because you are going to be born again, of course, have the Holy Spirit, get cleansed by the blood of Jesus, walk in righteousness, operate as a king. And you, having been born again, receiving the Holy Spirit, and you come to the place of getting the blood applied to everything that you might have sinned, you get yourself to the place of being the holy priest before the Lord. God has got this work. It's all laid out. It's all set. And it continues on. We got a lot more to talk about, and we're going to continue tonight as we talk about being led through the spiritual wilderness to possess the promised land and become the holy nation and to become everything that God has for you. Say this, Heavenly Father, I thank you and praise you for the Word of God that brings revelation that I am in the spiritual wilderness from the day I got born again. And I thank you that I am going to pass the tests. I will conquer the attacks of the devil. I will learn the ways of the Lord. I will never complain or gripe or murmur against the Lord. I will walk in line with the covenant to see the covenant promises come to pass. I understand all these things are examples and warnings to me. They're types and shadows of the realities. I will pass the test. I will be a doer of the word. I thank you that as I walk in your ways and follow the word of God and be obedient to these types, working out my salvation in the spiritual wilderness, conquering the enemy, I will become a holy nation, the holy sanctuary for the habitation of the Lord, for you to come and dwell in me, to become the perfected church that will be washed clean, that will be ready, firm, established, fixed, perfected for the coming of Jesus Christ to meet him in the air. I will be a part of the glorious, perfected church because I will walk in your ways. Thank you, Lord. I commit, just as they were saying, all that the Lord has spoken, I will do it. I will carry it out in the name of Jesus. Thank you for performing your mighty work in my life because I am a hearer and a doer of your word. In Jesus' name, amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you for revelation that has come forth this day. We thank you that we have ears to hear and understand how you laid all these things out in the Old Testament with the types and shadows, and showing us what is to be accomplished in our life to see your work be done. It will be done in us because we will be hearers and doers of your word. And all that you've said, we will do it. Thank you for performing it. In Jesus' name, amen. Praise God.